called his name Jabez, saying, because I bear him with sorrow. I bear him with sorrow. Aha, I need you to look at that now. I bear him with sorrow. Verse 10, and Jabez called on the God of Israel, saying, oh, that thou wouldest bless me indeed and enlarge my coast, that thy hand might be with me, that thou wouldest keep me from evil, that it may not grieve me. And God granted him that which he requested. In other words, the verdict was reversed. I put something there and I go to a topic that I've been taking for some time now, which is in 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 18. This charge I commit unto thee, son Timothy, according to the prophecies which went before on thee, that thou might, note it now, that thou by them might war a good warfare. That by them that thou might what? War a good warfare. Holy Spirit, thank you once more again. Take all the glory in Jesus' name. I want you to understand that when we talk about reversing the verdict, thank God we are seeing a month of divine intervention. And so when we talk about reversing the verdict, we are simply saying that you can change anything that you don't want. And so when we talk about verdict, we talk about the outcome of a matter, or the outcome of a product. So when we say verdict, oh, what is the verdict? This is the verdict. There was a vote. Okay, this party voted and this one voted. They say, what is the verdict? And they tell you, this is the verdict. Ladies and gentlemen, then tonight, I want to look at a situation where I realize that any verdict is reversible. Anyone is reversible. For instance, if there's any manipulation from any quarter when election takes place, they begin to go to court. And they start from the lower court to the higher court, which you call the Supreme Court. And by the time you know it, Supreme Court now overturns the verdict. It means that whoever is there, whoever it favors, begin to dance, begin to celebrate, begins to jubilate. So wherever you are tonight, I want you to know that your season of jubilation just started now as we are about to pray. Ladies and gentlemen, there's a man here, I just want to be very brief. There's a man here called Jabez. The Bible says the mother named him Jabez. And note it, the father's name did not come up at all. There was nobody to speak for him. There was nobody to help him reverse the verdict. The mother named him and he sticks like that. Why? The mother said, because I gave birth to him with sorrow. In other words, the package that delivered him on earth, there was sorrow in it. She said, I gave birth to him in sorrow. So the word Jabez there simply means sorrow. And so it means that for this kind of person, the verdict over him is anything he put his hand is going to end up in sorrow. As you are listening to the sound of my voice, your mother may not have called you Jabez, but I want to say, who placed a verdict over your life? For this man called Jabez, did you notice that nobody talked about the father? Because I try to look at the place of father when it comes to this situation. And I realized that it was possible for father to reverse the verdict. Because we are told that man is the head of the home. I can go on in Genesis 35, verse 18 of 35. Read it down, but verse 18 precisely. You're going to read the story of a man called Jacob. You know, Jacob had a wife called Rachel and all. But guess what? Rachel had a delay in childbirth. In Genesis 30, one day in frustration, she said to Jacob, give me a child or else I die, she said. The next time she was going to have a child, she actually died. Please be careful of what you say in frustration, because what you say can be taken against you in the court of heaven. Ladies and gentlemen, the next time she will have a child in chapter 35, the Bible tells us that she travailed in hard labor. She travailed in hard labor. that labor. Not quite long, the Bible says she gave birth. In that labor, she could not behold a child. But the few things she could mutter out of her mouth is, this child is called Benoni. She named the child Benoni. And I also realized the child, that word Benoni and Jabez is the same thing. Interchangeably, they are the same. Benoni means son of sorrow. It means son of sorrow. While Jabez means child of sorrow. Did you notice that? Both of them, their mothers played a part. Their mother played a part. They put a stamp of sorrow on them. They put a stamp. They put a seal. So anywhere Jabez goes, sorrow follow him. Anywhere Benoni goes, sorrow ought to follow him. But thank God for the Jacob fathers of our generation. Jacob's father turned around. Jacob, his father, turned around and said, "Ma, I renounce this. I reject this. I reverse this verdict. I reverse this verdict. You can't call him Benoni. I know you gave birth to him. Two of us are involved here. So I want to call his name Benjamin." So the word Benoni was switched instantly to Benjamin. I can go on and on. Did you notice that even when they plotted to kill one of the sons of Rachel, Benjamin was protected? All along, Benjamin enjoyed. Benjamin ate life with 32 fingers. Everything was the last born of the home. As a matter of fact, it was one of them that when the father said, when Joseph eventually said, "I need to see Benjamin," did you notice that even Reuben put his life at stake and told the father, "Don't worry, I must bring Benjamin back." You know why? He's the son of the right hand. The word Benjamin means son of the right hand. So there's a place for what I call the place of the father. There's also the place of the mother. Do you know some of us, whatever you are going through now, I want to ask, who is it that interceded for you? Some of us, we lack intercession. No, parents were not there to intercede for us. Mother was not there to intercede for us. There are some of you listening to the sound of my voice. Your mother may have been a prostitute, but guess what? Your father may have been a wayward person, and they were not there for you. But guess what? You can begin to reverse that verdict. You can reverse it. So, ladies and gentlemen, if you watch, the father was not there. Jabez's own father was not there to say, "No, we don't want to call this child Jabez." Could have called him favor. Could have called him blessing. Could have called him beraka. He could have called him whatever. But guess what? That was not the case. The stamp was on him. But if I can play the film in my mind, I want to see Jabez as he grew up. Everywhere he goes, sorrow follows him. If Jabez decides to travel from one nation to another, sorrow will be waiting for him in the airport. I realize that everywhere Jabez goes, doors will close. Some of you listening to the sound of my voice, why is it that things are closing against you? Why is it your name may not have been Jabez, but I want to say, which verdict is over your life? Which conclusion is over your life? When I see a person, sometimes I can tell you the type of verdict. This thing does not have to do with individual. Sometimes nationally, sometimes locally. In some villages, once you mention you are from that village, the verdict there, everybody knows it. People run away from you. What is the verdict over Nigeria? Nigeria ought to be a blessed nation. I remember once upon a time I was traveling in the plane. I was with a man, a white man. We were talking, and the man got me engaged in a lot of things, issues, and we started talking with the kind of way I was giving him solution. He looked at me and said, "Wow, this is awesome. I didn't see it from this path. You look intelligent, man." He said to me, "Where are you from?" And I said, "I'm in Nigeria." Guess what? This man switched off. That was the end of discussion. He liked me as a person, but what? The verdict over Nigeria tried to overshadow me there. Ladies and gentlemen, throughout, before we landed, this man never talked with me again. What am I trying to say? I'm letting you understand, when there's a verdict over a nation, when there's a verdict over a family, when there's a verdict over an individual, ladies and gentlemen, there is nothing you do. I want to give another example. Why I say you can change it is what I'm looking at tonight. I want to ask, You go to a medical doctor, because I know many people have their own. When we preach like this, they tend to say, "Hey, pastor, you don't understand. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. All things are passing away." Yes, it's true. But this verdict is there. You have to spend time to reverse it. That's why Jesus said, you know, that if you shall say to this mountain, let me give an example. So you realize that when this verdict is there, let me talk with some of you listening to me. You go to a medical doctor complaining of an ailment. The doctor has a stethoscope. The next thing, after examining you here and there, he looks at you and he looks straight into your eyes and asks you, "Sir, does anybody have this thing in your family?" What's the doctor saying? He was simply saying there's a verdict in your family. He was simply saying, does anybody, this verdict I'm seeing in your life, it doesn't look like somebody have it in your family. Then you are going to say, well, and you are told that your father died of such and such ailment. Then the doctor now knows how to manage your situation. You know why? The thing is flowing through your bloodline. Because why? There is a verdict. I can go on and on. Verdicts are reversible. In Numbers chapter 27, there were some group of girls who went to Pastor Moses. They said, "Pastor Moses, we have an objection. We have an objection. There's a verdict over ladies. There's a verdict over women. You went to the mountaintop. You brought out 10 commandments. And this commandment you brought down, we realize that there is no room for the female. There is no room for female, because according to what we are seeing here, Any man that has no male child, when such man dies, his property is simply switched to another family, while his daughters will be suffering." And this guy said, "Sir, we have come to reverse this verdict. We have come to say objection to this verdict. We have come to say no to this malady. We have come to say no to this reproach. Sir, we came to say no." Do you know that Moses was confused? Because it took Moses 40 days and 40 nights in the mountain to bring this commandment. How can I just reverse it now? Moses was confused. And the Bible says Moses turned aside to the Lord. And the Lord said, "Grant them the verdict. Reverse this verdict. Give them their property." It didn't take God 1 second to reverse the verdict. Tonight, wherever you are hearing the sound of my voice, any verdict over your family, any verdict over your nation, every verdict over your life is about to be reversed in 1 second. In the name of Jesus. Because if there's a man to pray, certainly there is a God to answer. That devil is a liar. I don't know who you are hearing the sound of my voice. What am I saying? This man, they named him Jabez. Nobody was there for him. Nobody was there to reverse. The father was not there. The uncles were not there. The mother labored him Jabez because she used her own situation to labor the child. Ladies and gentlemen, it was not the child that made the woman to give birth in sorrow. It was not a child, but guess what? The child took the residue. The child took the thing. The stigma was on the child. So anywhere Jabez goes, nothing work. If Jabez gets a job, in few months time, they will sack him. If Jabez is looking for a house, I tell you, somebody else will pay for it. If Jabez wants to get a land, somebody else will buy the land. If Jabez is about to buy a good car, somebody else takes over the car. Why? Because there's a stigma of sorrow on him. Anytime Jabez drives a brand new car, the car has to break down on Third Mainland Bridge. Because why? There is a stigma of sorrow on his life. So Jabez is simply sorrow. So some of you listening to me tonight, I want to declare that every verdict over our lives that is not of God is about to be reversed. In the name of Jesus. I realize these verdicts also, they are not just placed by parents. Sometimes wicked forces place it over people. Some satanic, what I call satanic principalities, they place it over people. They can just stand in a family. They put a stigma. They put a verdict on everyone in the home. They look at everyone in that village and they decide and say, "Nobody will have such and such sanctions in this family." And you just realize you are struggling. You just realize that things are not going the way you want. You just realize that you want to become, but you can't become. I don't know who I'm talking to tonight. I know God is set to visit you. I know your story is about to change, turn around. It could be sickness. It could be disease. You don't know where it came. All you know now is that you are sick. The devil is a liar. In John chapter 11, there was a young man there. The Bible says one day they said to Jesus, they said, "Master, behold, he whom thou lovest is sick." The sickness made a mistake. The devil made a mistake because there was a connectivity between Lazarus and Jesus. If God be for you, no power can be against you. I'm not saying they will not try, but certainly they will fall. You know why? The Bible says, surely they shall gather. Not by me, I'm not in their gathering, that they will scatter. Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to know, you don't win by crying. You don't win by sorrow. You don't win by being sad. You don't win by sitting in pity party. You don't win by folding your hands. You don't win by saying, eh, sera, sera. You don't win by saying, whatever we be, we be. Ladies and gentlemen, whatever we be can be changed in the altar of prayer. That's why we are here tonight. That's why we are about to make decree tonight. That's why we are going to tell the devil who the boss is tonight. Let me quickly show you something. He told Timothy, he said, this charge I commit to thee. What did he say, son Timothy? He said, according to the prophecies. Now, let me tell you, we see it on the positive. Do you know people, there are people that evil prophecies on their lives? Jabez is an example. According to the prophecies. In other words, Timothy, can you not see this prophecy over your life? Because of this prophecy, you have to war a good warfare. You have to reverse this thing. You've got to tell this thing enough is enough. So when he talked about prophecies, we are not just talking about positive prophecy. We are also looking at the negative one. That thing that makes you to, it's almost your turn, but it's never your turn. You are about to fetch. You are not being there. How do I know? The daughters of Jethro, we are told they were about seven. They kept going to fetch water. They were not wayward girls. They were girls that were very well cultured, well hardworking, well behaved, well cultured, well mannered. If as a matter of fact, also beautiful. But guess what? There were seven of them. No man will look at them to say hello. No man look at them to say, hey, hi. No man to say, we look at them and say, I want to marry you. They were dead. They had good behavior. They were not wayward. They were not seen in disco. Where were they? They were connected to their father. They were going all the time to make sure they fetch water. They were serving. You know, there are sons and daughters who don't know how to serve their parents. They want to be vagabond. They want to just think that life starts from the top. Life don't start from the top. Life starts from the ground. You make your way to the top. You have to know, if you are not learning, you will be lean very soon. Ladies and gentlemen, these girls were fetching water for their father. They kept going to fetch water. They kept going to, but there was a problem. Each time they go fetching water, they never return on time. There's a delay. In that family, delay. Delay in marriage. Delay in fetching water. Delay in bringing good things home. Delay in testimony. Delay in promotion. How? The Bible said there were some group of shepherds who sits on their well. The shepherd will say, we know you are coming here to fetch water. Let me see how you will fetch it. Any power sitting on your destiny, any power that say you cannot be who God say you will be, tonight we will reverse the verdict. In the name of Jesus, ladies and gentlemen, these guys came. They were wondering, hey, how is it going to be today? How shall this thing be? Ladies and gentlemen, while they were fetching water, these shepherds came again. They drove them away like yesterday. They drove them away like last year. They drove them away like last month. They drove them away like last week. They drove them away in the same way. And while they were driving them away, there was a Moses who was looking. May God raise timely helpers for you. Not knowing that there was a timely helper. God put Moses there. God said, no, 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 no. David said, no, this is injustice. Who is chasing these girls? And he went to help them and to discomfit and to scatter this group of satanic shepherds and help them to fetch the water. And these girls took the water home. By the time they got home, I like this Bible. I love this thing. Ladies and gentlemen, by the time they got home, their father looked at them. He said, daughters, you can read it all in Exodus chapter 2. He got home, he said, daughters, how is it that you came so soon today? How is it that you come on time today? How is it that you were able to break the yoke of delay today? How did you reverse the verdict of delay? In our family, water not they come on time. In our family, when they go out, they don't bring good news on time. In our family, when they work, promotion don't come on time. When they go out, good things don't. How is it that you came so soon today? Karabaku sataya galaba. Irakata kabalibrogodo. Ezegede barakata. Ambrondoli kasekete. Every
every yoke of delay over your life, we command it broken in the name of Jesus. We break that delay. I say we break that delay. We break the yoke of delay. Ladies and gentlemen, I am looking at reversing the verdict. Have you not seen an intelligent young man who wants to go to school? But to go to school, it's not just possible. It's not just possible. One thing we always stop the young man. One thing we always stop the lady. One way or the other. Have you not seen people who attempt to travel? They get a visa, but guess what? They are thrown back at the airport. Not a fake visa, but somebody with a fake visa crossed the same airport. Someone that went with a fake visa crossed the airport. Someone that went with a genuine visa was brought back. I want you to understand that there are verdicts. If you don't reverse the verdict, the verdict will reverse your destiny. You have to know that the devil is a liar. You are not going to permit him. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm talking about the place of intercession. If you are listening to the sound of my voice, take evaluation of your family. Look at it. Some of you, you didn't grow up to know your father. Some of you, you grew up to know your father. There was nothing to write home about it. So even not to talk of your mother. This is the reason why you have to give your life to Jesus. This is the reason why you have to stand your ground well. This is the reason why you have to stay in a praying church. This is the reason why you tell yourself enough is enough. Today, when you see the way evil is being promoted, you ask yourself, what does this generation, how is it, where are we heading? A generation that we put boys and girls in the same room, lock them up, put camera to be watching them, and they'll be having sex life on camera. Then you ask yourself, they are being celebrated. By the time one comes out, anyone who commit more sin is the winner. Then when he or she comes out, he's giving accolades. When he or she comes out, either with a car or one thing or the other, then you have somebody else who is reading. Who is reading? You have somebody else who loves the Lord, reading. And yet, the world will tell you no. Look at what is happening today all over the world. You see, lie is being celebrated. They celebrate lies. They support lies. Immediately, truth come on board. They try to cover the truth. But guess what? You can cover the truth for some time. You can never cover it all the time. It's only a matter of time. The truth will always speak for itself. The truth can defend itself. Don't ever forget that. Hallelujah. Quickly tonight, how do I reverse this verdict? Looking at Timothy, you realize he said to him, he said, I charge you. In other words, Timothy was connected to Apostle Paul. He was connected to Apostle Paul, and so he had a mentor. If you don't have a mentor, you will have a tormentor. He had a mentor. He had someone who had an insight on spiritual matter. He said, son Timothy, from this kind thing I see you, they go through today. This kind thing you are going through too. So, Timothy, you have to war a good warfare. You've got to stand. I've seen people who laugh at us. I've seen people who laugh at prayers. I've seen people who preach against prayers. I want all of you listening to the sound of my voice. Whether you are a man of God, please don't condemn any other man of God. Nobody have access to the whole scripture. You can preach in part and prophesy in part. The way you are seeing it, if I open it, I may be seeing it from another direction. All we are doing is to compliment the kingdom. Don't let's come out and wash our dirty linen outside. Everyone have access to this social media. We should not. If somebody is preaching, leave the person. You preach your own. Don't bother to talk about this. Don't bother to counterize someone's message. You were not there. How about at the end, you now realize it was God who was speaking. What will you say? That means you stood against God. All of you hearing the sound of my voice. He said to Timothy, Timothy, he said, by this kind of thing you are going through, Timothy, according to the prophecies, according to the curse when they're your family, according to the curse when they're your head, so, Timothy, can't you see? You have to war a good warfare. Timothy, you know, she's saying a curse you they carry. Excuse me, allow me to speak pidgin, please. Timothy, can't you see you are cursed? Can't you see what is happening to you? Can't you see your life is not going forward? Can't you see what you're going through? Timothy, I charge you right now. What the charge is that you've got to war a good warfare. So what's a good warfare? A good warfare is your prayer life. warfare is what we are about to do. A good warfare is when you take authority to reverse verdicts. A good warfare is when you take on spiritual authority. Because one thing you should understand is the spiritual that controls the physical. Don't ever tell me, listen, any physical fight has, it has limitation. But guess what? Spiritual one in the air, I'm telling you, it enters into generations to come. And as you are listening to the sound of my voice. So he said to Timothy that you might war a good warfare. I don't want to go so deep into it. So how do I reverse it? Like I said, good warfare. Reverse it through good warfare. Prayer. A praying church. A place where prayer is emphasized. A place where you know insights and revelations to what you are going through is released. That is one of it. The next one is a covenant. You have to stay in covenant with God. I have some things I need to say here. Now, give me your attention. You see, why you need covenant? You see, people like Daniel, they were in Babylon. Babylon has swallowed them up. They were in Babylon. There was pandemic. They were in Babylon. They gave a law in Babylon that nobody should pray. Did you notice that? That was what they said. That nobody should pray. They didn't say nobody should even go to church. They said nobody should pray at all. Don't even bother to pray. That's what they told Daniel. Can you not see what is happening today all over the world, where people's mouth is being gagged, where people are not allowed to pray? Can you not see what we are saying? A demon called coronavirus came into town and prayer was extinguished to the back. And why are they exquisiting prayer? Because the powers that hash the thing know that if there is prayer, it will not last. But guess what? They made a big mistake, because when they can stop the prayer in church, but they can't stop the prayer in the houses. The prayer will multiply. Ladies and gentlemen, they told Daniel, don't pray. I want to tell you what Daniel did. I'm talking about covenant number two. You remember, this is important. Catch this, please. Don't miss what I'm about to say. Please catch this. Now, what did Daniel do? The Bible says, Daniel went to his house. He opened his window in the direction of Jerusalem. In the direction of Jerusalem. What was he activating? Covenant. What was he having? Because when Solomon was dedicating the temple, one of the things Solomon said, he said, if anybody anywhere will stand and face towards Jerusalem, he said, oh Lord, answer their prayer. Anybody who will face this area, this temple called Jerusalem, Lord, grant their request. What was he doing? He was activating that covenant. He was activating the covenant with Jerusalem. Ladies and gentlemen, all of you hearing the sound of my voice, I want you to understand that covenant works. You have to enter covenant with God. Don't just be a churchgoer. Don't just be someone lost in the church. You can create miracle. Miracle can be manufactured. If you cooperate with God, you can always take delivery of miracle. In fact, you will distribute miracles. You know why? These signs shall follow them in my name. That is the covenant we're talking about. So what did Daniel do? Daniel opened the window. He faced Jerusalem. He began to kabash. He began to kabash. He began to say, Lord, I remember your servant Solomon said, anybody who will face this direction, that you will answer the prayer. And he began to say it. Guess what? You know what? Everything was reversed. Because when that day, when he prayed that prayer, they caught him. They threw him in lion's den. Guess what? The God of covenant entered the lion's den. The God of covenant entered. He said, this young man call upon me, I come. He came in. Because when you face that temple, what was he activating? He was activating the covenant of the lion tribe of Judah. He was saying, lion tribe of Judah, they may send me to lion's den, but I am calling on you. Ladies and gentlemen, the lion said, don't worry, when you get there, I'll be waiting for you. When they threw him there, the lion tribe of Judah met the other lions and said to them, I am your king. I have arrived. I'm sent. Somebody is coming to join us in this conference. His name is Daniel. But it's not just Daniel. He also belongs to our tribe. He's also a lion. You know, lions don't eat lion. So this one is uneatable. But if we release him, I will bring better meat. Come give you now. Ladies and gentlemen, hearing the sound of my voice, I want you to understand that we can reverse verdict. We can say no to whatever the enemy is bringing our ways. I am so blessed this night. Amen, 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 amen. Quickly. So like I said again, that's number two, right? Number three is enter intimacy with the Holy Spirit. If you don't know the Holy Spirit, you are wasting your time in church. You are wasting your time. You are, in fact, you are a monumental waste if you have been a Christian for a long time and you have no intimacy with the Holy Spirit. Then you are just a waste in Christianity. Ladies and gentlemen, activate your relationship with the Holy Spirit again. Especially in this season, especially this time, that the devil is making a big mistake. Because if you don't have the Holy Spirit, when it's time to give the mark, you may be the first on the queue. Because you won't even know. There will be nothing to quicken you. There will be nothing. Can't you remember? Even when we are talking about all this mark and all, there were men of God that came out and we are laughing at people. There were men of God who stood on social media. They were laughing at other men of God. How can they say this? How can they say that? How can they say 5G? How can they see this? They began to laugh at people. All of you hearing the sound of my voice, like I said, please mind your business and also hear from God directly. If anybody tells you, does hear the Lord, if you don't want to switch off, instead of you to go and start counterizing what the person is saying, please mind that. It's important that we compliment, we don't compete. It's important. Hallelujah. So have intimacy with the Holy Spirit. You remember Jesus Christ? He said, I will not leave you comfortless. He said, I will send another in my name. I will send another. He will teach you all things. He will be with you. He will abide with you. So who is that another? He's talking about the person of the Holy Spirit. It's a person. Invite him into your home. Invite him into your family. Very important. Very important. Hallelujah. Another one point. Let's look at that of Jabez, because that's where we are going to be praying with tonight. Now, looking at the system of Jabez, what did he do? The Bible says, and Jabez was more honorable than his brethren. So number five, thank you. Number five, hear me now. Looking at Jabez, what did Jabez do? He was more honorable than his brethren. So you have to place demand on integrity. No matter what you want, all of you hearing me, you are a man of God, you are whoever you are, politician, whoever, students, all, but hear me again. Place demand on integrity. Integrity is what will stand for you tomorrow. Because why am I saying this here? Everything can fail. Money can fail. But your integrity cannot fail. It's important you don't forget this. He says, and Jabez was more honorable than his brethren. He was more honorable than, he placed demand on integrity. You have to place demand on it. In as much as you are a Christian, hear me, while you are looking for anointing, please also place demand for character. If you don't have the right character, your anointing will not last. Character is very good. We have to lay demand on it. Let our yes be yes. Everything is not about money. If you follow money, you may mourn. I know money is good. The Bible says money answered all things. Yes, but please, don't let it be love for money. Place demand on integrity. Place demand. He says, and Jabez was more honorable than his brethren. We live in a society where people can just come up and you know, flout some things. It does not matter how the money is made, especially our youth today. All I need is to buy a Mercedes Benz. All I need is to buy, I'm not doubting. But guess what? If you don't go on that lane, you will still have the Mercedes Benz. Because there's nothing God cannot give you. So lay demand on what? Integrity. It's important. Lay demand on it. The next one is he activated the prophetic blessings of Genesis chapter 1 verse 28. I can read it for you. He said, and Jabez, verse 10 says, and Jabez called on the God of heaven, saying, oh, that thou wouldest bless me indeed. Note it now. Thou wouldest bless me indeed. Genesis chapter 1 verse 28.
it says, and God blessed them. Genesis 1:28.
So what was he doing? He was activating it. He may have read the scripture. He may have said to himself, if God bless me, how come I am suffering? If God bless me, how come my mother renamed me? Before my mother named me Jabez, God has said, my name is Blessing. Why did my mother name me this? No, my name from today will be Blessing. So he began to activate. So it means that you've got to bury your head in the Bible. In the scripture, it's your picture. Take time out and search your true picture in the scripture. The man went to the scripture and searched and discovered that God had blessed him. He said, then, why am I going through this? Remember Daniel, as I ran up before we pray, Daniel realized that they were in Babylon. 70 years had passed, but the prophecy says that they will be 70 years in desolation. They were going to be 70 years in captivity. And 70 years passed. Daniel said, then why are we still here in captivity? That was when he began to pray. He began to call on God and say, Lord, our story must change. This verdict must be